Cecil was reported here that got pretty tonight.
I need my earbud.
So we're gonna get started, we'll see, I'm gonna pray for us real quick, then grab the inbox and turn the page to 426, and we'll say victory in Jesus. We'll say what we got. Father, we thank you for your many blessings, and Lord, we thank you tonight for the folks that's come. I pray a special blessing on each home, each man, Father, as they try to leave their homes, would you just help them tonight? Encourage as only you can, and Father, I pray that your will be done, not only in our heart, but in our homes and our churches. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Stand with us. If you love the Lord tonight, say amen.
Amen.
Don't you want to worship him tonight and praise him?
Yeah.
Let's sing. Come on.
Consider all the worlds I have.
Like that, or the incarnation spring of the Bible that he loved.
Enjoyed the singing tonight, gentlemen. I tell you what, it's a different sound when you hear a congregation of men singing. And I enjoyed that. That's something I hadn't experienced in my lifetime, and I really enjoyed that. So how many of you enjoyed it so far? Amen. You've been blessed. Praise the Lord for that. And I want to thank the ladies and the folks that have part in the cooking for us. How many of you full, fat, and happy right now? Amen. Yeah, what a blessing. Brother Cecil, I'm honored to introduce you, and we thank you. Our paths has crossed several times here at the church, and I believe that you are a man of God, and I believe that you honor the Lord in your preaching, and I look forward to hearing what God's given you tonight for us. Well, Brother Cecil, if you'd come, we appreciate you in the Lord. Amen.
Solid
there, right?
That's right. Yeah. I'm a man. I'm good. Good morning. That's what we'll say here directly. Amen. Appreciate the opportunity to come and minister to you tonight. I was telling some folks earlier that I've preached in a lot of places 5 years or so. A lot of different churches all over the place. And I would have to say this is one of my favorite. And I don't say that to all of them. I don't just say that to say it. But this is one of my favorites. This is one of the freest churches I've preached in my lifetime. And I just thank God for it. Y'all got something special going on here, and it's called the Spirit of the Lord. And it makes it easy to come in and minister the gospel. And I appreciate the opportunity. I thank you guys for coming out on a Thursday night. This is pretty amazing to get some folks out on a weeknight, and especially this time of day. How many of y'all usually going to bed about now? Be honest. Praise the Lord. Me too. Yeah, I was sitting there getting ready to get up, and I think I need to get down. Amen. But we'll do it for the Lord. How many of you remember a day when you stay up all night for the devil? Anybody in here? So we can hang out with the Lord tonight, and I guarantee you it'll be worth your while, hopefully here in a minute. Appreciate the opportunity to minister the gospel. I take it very seriously. I've never took it lightly, Pastor. The Bible says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. And every time I've ever spoke in the pulpit or out of the pulpit in ministry, I've took it to heart. Because I believe that the Scripture says that we're all going to give an account one day for every word and every deed. Amen. So I'm going to have to give an account for this service tonight. Amen? So, sometimes you'll see something maybe on TV and they'll put a warning label up. What you're about to see is graphic. Thought about it on the way down here tonight. I need to give you a warning label. What you're about to hear is graphic. Amen? Amen? Thought about it. I'm going to just warn you. Tonight, tomorrow, and Saturday morning, I may say some things that are going to be strong that the Lord has laid upon my heart. Amen. And it may offend some of you, and trust me, I don't do that on purpose. But anybody that's ever heard me preach more than once know that I'm just straight as they're going to get. I started this ministry over 25 years ago, and I prayed a prayer like this. I said, God, don't ever, ever let anybody leave confused after I've got done preaching. Amen. I don't want anybody to get in the car on the way home and say, I wonder what he meant when he said that. On the way home, I want them to know what I meant when I said it. Amen. Good to preach among men. I've had the privilege to do this several times, and it's a little different because you're always looking for that one woman to amen yawn. So anybody want to fill that spot tonight, raise your hand. Oh, praise the Lord. Amen. I wasn't expecting nobody. Amen. But you amen me on if you like it. If you don't like it, grit your teeth and we'll just get right in there together. Amen. If you brought your Bible tonight, I'm going to preach to us men tonight. And I'm going to preach. And my prayer is when I get done tonight that we'll be down here at the altar of God and we'll be getting things right with the Lord. Amen. I found out one thing in my Christian walk. Once I get to the place where I feel like I'm good, God will show me how far I am from being good. You know what the Bible says? It says there's none good. No, not one. Amen. So we need help from God. How many of you believe that us as men need a touch from God Almighty? Amen. We need it. Amen. I'm going to go over some things tonight and try to put things in perspective. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in the book of Psalms, and I'm going to read a psalm to you tonight, and I'm going to preach on it tonight and tomorrow night, and then we're going to finish up. Yeah, I promise if you hang with me till Saturday morning, I believe God's going to do something great. Amen? Praise the Lord. Psalm 1. That ain't hard to find. It's at the beginning. Psalm 1. Scripture says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Verse 2, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. Verse 3, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season, and his leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Verse 4 says, the ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Amen. I want to talk to you about being blessed, the blessed man. What the blessed man actually means is the happy man. Who in here is happy?
Amen.
Amen. Let me ask you one more time. Who in here is happy?
Amen.
Amen. I asked the church a few weeks ago, I said, who in here is happy? And they sit there like some of you, and they went like this. Amen. I asked them again, I said, who in here is happy? And they went, praise the Lord. I said, well, some of y'all's got to tell your face because your face don't know how happy you are. How many of you know when you're happy, your face will tell on you? Amen. Amen. Happy. I want to talk about the blessed man and the way to be a blessed man. In other words, a happy man. Now, we live in a messed up world today. How many of you agree? Amen. This world's upside down. I never would have thought that I'd have seen what's going on in the world I live in today. Never would have thought it. I thought about it on my long ride down here this evening, and I began to think how things have progressed so quickly in the world that we live in today, and how that it's beginning to attack. Actually, the attack began long ago, and we'll get into that in a little bit, but this is a men's meeting, amen, and it began to attack men. And men, I want to see blessed men. I'm talking about happy men. And happiness, somebody said, money don't buy you happiness. People fight over that all the time. They'll say, well, I'm sure I'd be a little bit more happier if I had a little more money. How many of you know that's not true? How many of you know that money and things is not going to ever buy you true happiness? I want you to know I've tried it. Amen. I've tried to buy stuff to satisfy. Amen. I've been down that road where I thought if I could just have that, I would be happy. Amen. I remember I looked at a car one time and I said, boy, I want that car. I'm a car guy, right? And I said, I'd like that car. And I said, I'm going to have that car one way or the other. I told my wife, I said, I'm going to buy that car. She said, good luck. How many of you know that most men, whenever they get something on their mind, they're going to make it happen one way or the other? And I said, I want that car bad. I said, I'm going to get that car. I want you to know within 6 months, that car was sitting in my driveway. I was walking circles around it. Oh, man, my chest was poked out. I wanted everybody to wave as it went by. Amen. I'd drive that thing to town. I'd wave, and nobody'd wave at me, and I couldn't figure out what was going on. I said, this is a nice car. What happened later on is somebody went up the road in a nicer car. And then I said, well, daggone, this car ain't good enough. I'd like to have their car. See, happiness, I want to talk to you about tonight, amen, is something that money cannot buy. Money can't keep. I'm talking about a blessed man of God. I'm talking about supernatural things tonight because we serve a supernatural God. How many of you know that God is holy? Amen. And the Bible says God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. I want to get you men, amen, to where you actually leave happy. Amen. Blessed of God Almighty. Amen. And blessing. Amen. Somebody said, well, I mean, they got a fine house and they got a fine car. That means they're blessed. That's not what I'm talking about tonight. Amen. You can live in a dump, amen, and ride a moped to church and still be happy. How many of you know that's true? Talk about happiness. The Bible said, amen, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of God. Amen. I want to try to get you to the position, amen, to where you'll understand why that the world's in the place that it's in today. Amen. It's because of counsel. It's because of ungodly counsel. Who are you listening to? Who is it that's speaking to you nonstop? We live in a high-tech age, and it's amazing to me that I can have a thought and print it on my phone and somebody will tell me what they think. It's amazing. Amen. Back in the day when I was a boy growing up, I didn't have that. If I had a thought, I just had to guess. How many of you know that's true? How many of you remember the good old days whenever you didn't have a cell phone? Anybody remember those days? How many of you remember the good old days whenever the phone was hooked to the wall? Amen. I remember the greatest thing ever happened in my life. Amen. Whenever we finally went from that to 3-foot cord to the 10-foot cord, I thought that was the greatest thing. I could slip around the corner in the house and tell my girlfriend that I love her without getting made fun of. We live in an age and today that the Bible says here, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. I begin to think in the counsel. The man is blessed whenever he walks in the counsel, not in the counsel of the ungodly. Walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. That doesn't mean necessarily that you're going to the pastor one-on-one and getting counseling. That's not what this scripture is necessarily talking about. You can go to the pastor and he can counsel you, amen, and hopefully he'll give you good godly counsel. If he don't, then somebody needs to go talk to him, amen. Amen. Good godly counsel. But I'm talking about the counsel that the world's getting today is not one-on-one, but it's what you're hearing. It's what you're seeing. And it affects you every day of your life. Men, I come to tell you tonight, amen, ungodly counsel is something that's running rampant in the world we live in today. What do you see and hear? What I found out, us men, ungodly counsel has been trying to destroy the masculinity in a man. Come on. It's been happening for years, but it's ramped up like I've never seen it before in my life, men. Amen. It's trying to make us where we don't even want to be proud to be a man anymore. But I'm here to tell you, God said, I created you in my image. Amen. He created men and he created women. And he created them different. How many of you know that's true? Amen. And the masculinity is what the devil wants to take away from the men in the world today. Amen. He wants us all to be equal. Amen. In his eyes. But I come to tell you tonight, we're not equal. Amen. In God's eyes. Amen. Why? He said, I created man and then I created the woman to help the man. He created the man to be masculine. Amen. Be a man. Somebody wants to say, yeah.
Lord, that's right.
Wouldn't it be great if we could be men again? Yes. Not a bunch of sissies. Told you I was going to, there's a warning. We're living in a day and age where they want to take that away from the man. I'm going to show you how it's happened, and it's probably slipped by you. It's happened almost incognito. How many of you remember a TV show back in the day called Little House on the Prairie? Raise your hand if you ever watched that. Y'all remember Charles Ingalls, don't you? Amen. He was a typical man, wasn't he? Amen. He would work on the farm. Amen. But I began thinking about that TV show earlier this week, and I began thinking there was deeper meaning in that show than what you might have got. Because if you begin to watch and begin to watch that show carefully, you'll see that it was typified as a household, amen, where the man was the head of the household. Because I remember several episodes where his wife Carolyn, amen, wanted to step up and say, don't do this. And he would gently grab her by the arms and he'd say, listen, we have to do it this way. And then she would look at the kids and she'd say, do what daddy said. Amen. It was a typical household. Amen. And I began to think, isn't that what God wanted to do? Amen. He wanted man to be the head of the house. That's what he said. Amen. He wants us to be the leaders. Amen. Step up and take charge and lead your family in the ways of God.
Amen.
You won't hear that preached much today. But you will hear a stupid statement like this. If she's happy, everybody's happy. Come on. How many of you ever heard that? If mama's happy, everybody's happy. That's dumb. That's dumb and it's not biblical. I didn't come to bash women. That's not what I'm doing at all. I'm putting us in the rightful place. Amen. I'm not saying for you to go home, kick the door down, smack your wife upside the head, drag her across the floor, amen, and say, I'm the man of the house. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying go in and say, listen, I want to lead us in the ways of the Lord. Amen. I remember whenever I met my wife and we got married, amen, and we decided to have some children, and I looked at my wife and I said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I said, you want to serve him with me? She said, I think I do. Amen. I said, you want to raise our children in the ways of the Lord? She said, I'm right behind you. She said, I'll never step over you. She said, you're the leader of this house. She said, take us on and lead us in the ways of the Lord. What a good woman. How many of y'all wish y'all had one like that? Woo! That's good preaching, ain't it? Amen. I'm telling you, God designed the man, amen, to stand up and take charge. Amen. That was a perfect example, little house on. He was a man that took charge of his family. Then about 1997, they had another TV show come out called Everybody Loves Raymond. Anybody remember that show? Yeah. If you watch carefully, you'll find that show showed a man right the opposite. You'll find a man that was scared to death of his wife and his mama. We sit and laugh like it was funny, but I've met more households like that than I have anything. Amen. A man scared to death. Amen. Afraid. He's afraid of his mama. Amen. I've had to look my mama in the eye sometimes and say, mama. She's come home, told me some things went on. I said, mama, you're going to have to straighten up on this. Somebody said, you rebuked your own mama. If she was wrong, she would me. I got a question for you. How many of you men would like to be honest with me tonight? Raise your hand. All right, put your hand down. Raise your hand if you're scared of your wife. So I said, I'll never do that among men. Listen to this. Ungodly counsel has been trying to take away man's place in the home. Can I tell you a little secret about my marriage? I found out some great things about being a man. Unusual things. But see, I was brought up around a generation to where the men, they never stepped foot in the kitchen. Any of y'all brought up that way? They didn't do the dishes. The woman done that. I thought, Lord of mercy, when I get married, the last thing I'm going to do is dishes. But you know what? I found myself in there doing dishes one day. And I tell you why I found myself in there doing dishes, because I read the scripture where the Bible said that I'm supposed to love my wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. Amen. And my wife was working, and she worked later than I did. And I thought, you know what? I said, I'm going to swallow my pride. I'm going to cook that woman some supper. Amen. I hate to wash dishes. I'm in there scrubbing the dishes. She said, honey, you don't have to do it. I said, oh, yes, I do. I will wash these for you because I love you very much. You see, God wants men to be men. Amen. And I'm talking the right way. Amen. Not overbearing, not controlling over his wife. Amen. But someone that's willing to lay down his life for his wife and say, what do you want me to do for you? I love you. And I'll tell you what. I found out one thing in marriage. Whenever I began to love my wife as Christ loved the church, she has absolutely no issue being subject unto me and letting me lead her in the way. That's good preaching, ain't it? The fastest way to miss your blessing is to take counsel from those who have no regard for God's view on life. It's amazing to me. I decided whenever I had children, I'd raise them up in the ways of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you right now, I wasn't the most popular dad in the world, but I'd done what I thought was right. And I wanted to be a man of God. And you know, I never remember gathering up one of my children whenever they were little. Could you imagine me taking my son when he was about the age of 3 and sitting him down, having a deep conversation with him, saying, listen, son, well, I can't call you son because that's not politically correct, but can I talk to you? And you know, you can decide what you want to be when you grow up. Amen. If you don't like what you are now, you can change what you are. Amen. You can become a girl later on. Listen, I told you there was a warning label. There it is. Amen. This is where we're at today, because men, amen, aren't right where they need to be in their own home. Amen. Who in their right mind would have a conversation with a 3-year-old and tell them they can decide, amen, what sex they want to be when they're older? But I did tell my kids this. I looked them dead in the eye. I said, you a young man, you a little boy, that's what you are. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. I sit my little daughter down. I looked at her and I said, you a princess. That's what I told my daughter. I called her that from the moment she was born on. Amen. And I treated them with love and compassion. Amen. But I also had a firm hand when it was necessary. How many of y'all ever wanted to whip somebody else's kids? Y'all ever been out in Walmart and want to whip somebody else's kids because they needed it? Wonder where dad's at? Want them to take them out and listen. And listen, this is what you need. You need a good whipping. That's what you need. Amen. Now, how many of you know some people need to be a man? Amen. I'm going to tell you what I told my brother one time, my little brother. As I told you, I'm a straight shooter. He got married and had three kids. When his last kid was born, he left his wife, ran off with another woman. I tracked him down. I looked him dead in the eye. I didn't call him on the phone, and I didn't text him. This was a meeting face to face. And I looked him dead in the face, and I looked him right in the eye. And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm in love with this other woman." I said, "No, you ain't." He said, "Yes, I am." I said, "One thing's for sure." I said, "You don't love your children, for one." Thought I was going to have to fight him over that one. He wanted to tell me how much he loved him. I said, "No." I said, "You're not being a man in this situation. You're a coward." Looked him in the eye and told him that. I said, "You're a coward." I said, "Be a man." He said, "I love it." I said, "No, you don't." I said, "But you do love somebody more than anything in this world." He said, "Who's that?" I said, "Yourself." I said, "Be a man, go home, take care of them kids." He said, "I don't love my wife anymore." I said, "I didn't ask you if you loved her no more." I said, "That's not up for debate." I said, "Be a man." I said, "Go home." I said, "It ain't about you no more. It's about them kids now." I said, "Go home and raise up them children." I listen, you want to get me irritated as a man of God? It's a man watching another man that's willing to lay in the bed and have a baby with another woman but won't take care of him, wants his mama or his grandmama, somebody else to take him. Listen, be a man of God. Amen. Take care of them children. Raise them up in the ways of the Lord. Amen. Be there night and day and night and day. Amen. Raise them up in the ways of the Lord. Amen. I tell you, I never, ever, ever come to my children on Sunday morning, looked them in the eye and said, "Do you want to go to church?" Never crossed my mind. I didn't go in there and say, "Micah, do you feel like going to church today, son?" I tell you what I did do. I opened the door and I said, "Church day, let's go to the house of the Lord." There was no ifs, ands, or buts. I raised my son to be a boy and turned him into a young man. Here's where it could get rough. I believe God wants us men to train up our children right. Teach them how to be a man. I'm going to make a statement. Pastor, you got me?
Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord. I think it's time that men got back to being men and raising their children to be men. Get them out of the basement. Amen. Get them off the video game and actually do something with them. Amen. Don't stick them in front of that little device there and let it occupy all their time. Be a man. Amen. Take them outside. Do something with them. I am proud to say that I had my son when he was barely able to reach the pedals of a 67 Nova, had him driving that thing. Somebody say, praise the Lord. A 3-speed on a column to beat it all. I said, how much better can you get? I mean, I told him, I said, when you're out there working on them, boy, I said, whenever you skin your knuckles and it's bleeding, I said, grab it first thing and pull a tab. I took my daughter. And I said, "You are beautiful." I said, "Don't you ever let nobody tell you anything different."
Amen.
I said, "God made you special." I started taking my daughter out on daddy-daughter dates when she was about 10 years old. And it continued until she was 19 years old. I would take her, brother, and I'd take her outside and I'd open the car door for her.
Amen.
I'd say, "Climb in there and sit down." I wouldn't take her to McDonald's, but I'd take her to the highest priced restaurant I could afford. I'd sit her down in fine dining, gentlemen. And I said, "You get whatever you want on that menu. I'm going to just tell you, that's dangerous. Take some money with you." But I walked in, I said, her name's Adley. I said, "Adley, you can get anything you want on that menu. We on a date." And I said, "Daddy's taking you out." I took her out and I'd open that car, we'd get back home. We'd have a most wonderful time. As the night ended, I'd look her in the eye and I'd say, "Let me tell you something, Adley." I said, "That's how a man's supposed to treat you." I said, with respect and with honor. I said, don't you ever accept anything less. I said, and you make sure he's a man of God. I said, hey, you make sure he ain't playing church. I said, he ain't a pretend Christian. I said, you make sure he loves Jesus with all of his heart. She's fixing to get married this July. She met a guy. She called me the other day. She said, Dad, she said, I told my fiance he needed to get to church and Bible study, that regular service wasn't enough. He needs Bible study because he needs to get closer to the Lord. What if we had men that raised children like that? How many of y'all have had all you can take? Raise your hand. That means it's coming. The Bible said not only the counsel of the ungodly, we need to stay away from that. Get away from whatever you're... Listen, you know you can look at your phone till it drives you insane. Amen. How many of you understand that? It used to be the TV. It's not that anymore. Most people will sit in their house and look at their phone while the TV's on. How many of you know that's true? Raise your hand if you're there. Amen. You carry it around. Amen. Almost like if you ain't got it, you will die suddenly. Amen. And we love that thing because it's a wealth of information. Amen. But how many of you know that thing is destroying this world that we live in? Amen. You ain't nobody even looking up at the sky no more. They just looking right there seeing what they can get. Amen. I'm going to tell you something. Be a man of God. Amen. Put that thing down. Grab a hold of the pages of the old book. Amen. Read and study it. At the end of the week, whenever your little phone there begins to give you that time that you spent on there, that screen time, amen, you see if it equals up to the time you spent with God Almighty and see where you stand with Him today. I guarantee you, you'll be like me. You'll hang your head low in shame and say, I failed you, God. I spent this much time on my phone and very little time with you. Put that phone down. The righteous man knows where to find completely godly counsel. Amen. You're looking at a young man today. I like to call myself that. You're looking at a man today that I needed good godly counsel. I remember when I got married and the first kid was on the way, Pastor, I cried to the Lord. And I said, Lord, I don't know what to do. I have no example before me. My daddy walked out of my mama when I was born. Left me and my two sisters. My mama married another man about a year later, which was a raging alcoholic and drug addict. That's the way I spent my life. And here I was getting married, getting ready to have a baby on the way, and I cried out to God, and I said, God, you're going to have to help me because I don't know what to do. I said, I don't know how to be a man of God. I don't know how to be a godly father. I said, I never had a daddy. But that still, small voice spoke in my spirit, brother. And this is what God said to me. I'll be your daddy. You say that's not biblical. Yes, it is. Because when we cry out, Abba, Father, that means daddy. Whenever he told me that, I began to weep. I said, God, you be my daddy. And you show me how to be a good husband and a good father. And he did just that. You can ask my kids. I wouldn't let them walk by me without grabbing them up. They said, Dad, come on, give it a rest. I said, I can't. I said, I love you too much. They would walk by my recliner. I'd grab them over, and I'd give them a big hug, and I'd look them dead in the eye and say, your daddy loves you with everything that's in him. And I said, not only that, but Jesus loves you more than daddy ever will. Amen. I've done that the whole time. Now my son, amen, which stands about this tall, which makes me very irritated, amen, but he's about this tall now, on his own, amen, out making a living for himself. He can be standing in a crowd of strangers, and we would depart. We were speaking. I said, I got to go. He'll say, well, come here, Dad. And
he'll grab me up and he'll hug me and he'll hold me tight and he'll say, Dad, I love you with everything that's in me. I said, well, oh, that's my father. Amen. He can make a man of God make another man of God.
I'm about to get down where I can preach at now. He said, not only watch who's counseling you. Listen, you got to watch what's going in your eyes and your ears. Can I give you a quick point before I go to number two? This is going to make some of you very mad at me, but I love you. How many of you believe what you allow come in your eyes and ears will affect your soul? I run a machine every day, sit on that machine, and I forced it up for years. I pick up Christian stations. I can hear preaching. I can hear, you know, singing. I can sit in there and just worship the Lord all day long. I moved to a different location, and the radio wouldn't pick up nothing but country music. And it's the old country that I was raised on. And I know the words to all the songs. So the first few days, I was like, I was in there singing, right? And I was having a time. That was all, I was raised on this stuff. I mean, this is all right. Some of you done got puffed up at me. But I found out after about a weekend, I started to change a little bit. I went from being joyful to concerned. Amen. Next thing I know, I began to walk in. I look at my wife. What you been doing? Who you been talking to? Oh, I didn't realize what was happening until it was too late. I even looked at my dog mean a time or two. I said, you know, I didn't know if he was going to leave with the next one coming along. I didn't know what was going on. And all of a sudden, I told my wife, she said, you're different. I said, she said, what's, I said, I don't know. I said, I feel different. I said, things are going through my mind that normally wasn't there. And, you know, and then all of a sudden, I popped out of the blue. I looked over at her. I said, I know what's wrong with me. I said, this is a soul over here that's carrying the body. I said, so my soul ain't been fed lately. I said, it's been fed on the things of this world, and it's got me thinking wrong. Amen. I need to get back to the things of God, put what's right in my eyes and what's right in my ears. Be a man of God once again. So I sit on that job for weeks in silence. 10 hours is a long time to sit and run a machine with nothing playing. Every time I'd get irritated, I'd say, God, feed me. Feed my soul. Listen to what he said. Not only watch who counsels you. He said, don't stand in the way of sinners. The path of sinners. The path speaks of a way, a road, a direction. I don't know if y'all realize this or not. This might be a revelation. The righteous man is not traveling in the same direction as sinners. You would think it'd be standard preaching, wouldn't you? Not for today's time. I'm so amazed at the push that's came into the church. The push that's come in that's trying to tell us you can live in sin openly and still yet go to heaven. Us as men, we should be heading in one direction. The scripture says for us to come out from among the world and be ye a separated people. What happened to the preachers that used to preach that way? How many of y'all was raised on that type of preaching that they preached years ago? That they come in and they said, want you to change. Amen. I want you to come out from among the world, be a separated people. Amen. If you look like the world, then chances are you're probably of the world. Amen. If you talk like the world, you're probably of the world. If you dress like the world, you probably are of the world. That's the way they used to preach, wouldn't it? They'd say, come out from among them, be ye a separated people. But we live in a day and era where we brought the world into the church.
Amen. And then we think we've got something. Amen. Let's make it worldly so we can get the people in. Amen. Let's do something different is what they said. Amen. Let's make it comfortable for people to come in. Amen. Don't you get mad at me, but I will preach the gospel to you. Amen. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Amen. You want to hear some good preaching tonight? Here it is. Amen. What the church needs is Jesus. What they need to do is start preaching Jesus Christ. Amen. Turn the lights back on and preach Jesus.
Praise the Lord. Thank the Holy Ghost for that. I get very upset. People have changed church to fit the world. I've been preaching for years. I told them, I said, listen. I said, this building should be the most uncomfortable place for your flesh that you could be in. Why? Because the flesh wars against the spirit, the scripture says. It's a battle continually. Amen. But the church and new church age is saying, let's make them comfortable in their flesh. No. Amen. He didn't say that in his word. He said the flesh fights against the spirit and it's a battle continually. Amen. The church is, if you come in the flesh, you should be uncomfortable when you get here and while you're here. But if you come in the spirit, amen, you should have a place of unity, of joy, of peace, of love. But if you're fleshly person, I guarantee you're going to get uncomfortable when you're around me. I told a church the other day, I said, I wish to the Lord that pastors would start being pastors again. Don't y'all get mad at me, but I'm going to preach what I think is right. I wish we'd bring respect back into the house of God. I wish we'd bring it back. I do. I wish us as men would bring respect back into this place. And we say we respect this place. We know that this is sticks and mortar and bricks. We understand that. But this is a place where we gather together. Amen. And we lift up his name. Amen. Listen, the pulpit used to be a place that was considered holy. Amen. We wouldn't let just any yahoo come in here and preach. Amen. Now we can let them openly live in sin and tell them, go ahead, stand in the pulpit and preach. Amen. I want to know where the men's at and the leadership of those churches. And why didn't they get somebody by the nape of the neck and drag them out back and say, listen, amen, you ain't preaching in here till you get your life right with God. Amen. That's the way it is. How many of y'all remember, y'all ever had any deacons that liked their job? I had a deacon one time in the church, loved that man. We told him, I said, listen, part of your job is keeping order in this service. That's what we told him. That's part of your job. If anybody gets out of order, would you take care of it? He said, I'd love to do that. What I loved the most was that if they had an unruly kid in the church that the mom and daddy couldn't do nothing with, he'd come over and he'd say, I'll take care of that kid for you. They'd say, please. He'd grab that kid and drag him out the back, screaming. And y'all know what he did when he got him out back? All I know was I wasn't there. But when they brought him back in, the little kid was snubbing. And they sit down and they was afraid to move. What happened to men like that? You see, we live in a society today where people say, well, we don't want to offend. What happens is that the society is so afraid of offending somebody that we're letting people die and go to hell all the way around us. There's a different path that men of God should be walking, and it should not be the way of the world. Amen. We're supposed to be a separated people. It's not the same road. The blessed person does not hang out with people who will influence him towards sin and away from God. I know whenever I say that you're not supposed to hang out with the ungodly, they'll come back and they'll say this. Well, how in the world are we supposed to reach them? I never said not go reach them. I said don't go hang with them. You know, in my life there are some places I would not go. Anybody ever been there? Worked for a company one time, boss come in and says, y'all done so good this year, we're going to take y'all out to eat. I said, that's great, we all like to eat. He said, y'all get ready, we're going tomorrow. Bunch of us men going out to eat, boss is going to take us. I said, where are we going?
He said, "We're going to Hooters." I looked at him, never cracked a smile or nothing. I looked at him, I said, "I'll be passing on this one." He looked at me, he said, "You ain't going?" I said, "No, sir." I said, "I pass on this one." He said, "Why?" I said, "Don't need to go in there." I said, "I got a woman at home waiting on me." And I said, "Why would I go in there and lust after another woman when I got the best one at the house I could ask for? Wouldn't it be great if we had men?" I'm going to tell you something. I've become the most hated man on the job because the boss looked at me. He said, "Well, if you ain't going, nobody's going." I looked over at them other men. I thought they was going to kill me. They looked over at me and said, "Really?" I said, "Hey." I said, "Y'all welcome to go." "No, no, none of us don't get to go." The boss said, "We'll take you to McDonald's." I said, "Praise the Lord for a Big Mac." See, men of God are not walking the same direction. We're walking in a totally different direction. And I'm going to just tell you something. This is page 1 of 8. Just kidding. The righteous man is not afraid to take the less traveled road. I come to tell you folks something tonight. I found out down through the years, if you want to be a man of God and you walk upright before your God, there'll be times you'll almost walk alone, you'll feel like. Whenever that, it's amazing to me that I've even found church folks don't even want to stand with me sometimes, Pastor. They'll say, "Your way's too straight. You're getting a little carried away now, Brother Cecil." I'll never forget, I made some folks mad in the church whenever I was raising my children. Because I sought the Lord. I said, "Lord, do not let me do anything that will hinder their soul." Because I knew their body would eventually go away, but their soul never would. And I prayed and I said, "Lord, lead me." Well, y'all may not like this, but I raised my children. I never taught them Santa Claus was real. Never. I felt like it took away from God Almighty. I never did. I wouldn't raise my children like that. We had Christmas, and I told them, I said, "Mom and Daddy worked hard and bought you them presents. But we're celebrating Jesus Christ and his birth. I mean, that's what we're doing today. This is all about Jesus." See, church people say it's all about Jesus and then celebrate everything else. But I raised them. I said it was a straight way. And I definitely never told them the Easter Bunny was real. I can't understand it at all. But I told them, I said, "This is about the resurrection. The way, the truth, and the life. Amen. This is the way we're going to raise you." My daughter, sometimes she would kick against it. She said, "Daddy, everybody else is doing it." I said, "We ain't everybody else. We walk in a different road. Amen. We're headed a different direction. Amen. I'm doing these things because I'm watching after your soul." Amen. And then I wouldn't let them participate in Halloween. And then that's when everybody got mad at me. And they said, "Lord, your kids was neglected. Go ask them if they were neglected. Probably spoilt rotten brats." It's a lonely road sometimes. He said, "Don't walk in the way of sinners." Do you know something miraculous happened on December the 15th, 1997? December the 15th, 1997, Pastor. Because on December the 15th, 1997, I went from being a drug addict, an alcoholic, a whoremonger, to a born-again child of God. Amen. That's what happened on December the 15th, 1997. That was on a Monday morning. God gloriously saved me. But I want to tell you something. Something crazy happened. Didn't nobody tell me to do nothing. All of a sudden, I accepted Christ into my heart that morning. I said, "God, help me, a drug addict. Help me, an alcoholic. Help me. I'm addicted to all kinds of things. God, would you help me?" My Lord and my God, something moved into this man. Amen. Amen. It's called the Spirit of God. Amen. And something left, which was called Satan and his, all of his devils out of hell. Amen. And there was a new residency inside of me. Amen. All of a sudden, I said, oh, Lord. Amen. I got to do something. Amen. I reached in my pocket and I said, Lord have mercy. I got some dope in here. Amen. I said, take me down to the creek. Walk down to the creek. Amen. I threw my dope in the creek. Amen. When I said, Lord, why did I do that? Amen. That's a lot of money right there. I said, but it felt good. Amen. Now, something was happening inside of this man. Amen. Threw my dope in the creek. Then I started back towards the truck and I said, whoop, whoop, whoop. This is going to make some of you mad. Whoop, whoop, whoop. I got to take them cigarettes. I threw them down in the creek too. Started back to the pickup. I said, whoop, there's my lighter. Threw it down too. Somebody says, that lighter scent. Nope. Just making sure. See, some of y'all got puffed up at that. No pun intended. But I'm going to tell you something. When the Spirit of God moves in you men, you're a new creature in Christ Jesus. He said, old things pass away. Behold, all things become brand new. I had a guy come over. I partied with him the week before. He came over that Tuesday evening. I found somewhere to go to church. I had dress clothes on. He pulled up my driveway. I'm standing there in dress clothes. He said, you going to town? I said, no, I'm going to church. He said, church? I said, yes, sir. I said, yesterday something marvelous happened. I said, I got saved. He said, from what? I didn't know what to say. I looked him dead in the eye. I said, hell, I reckon. He said, well, Cecil, I was with you 3 days ago. We done drugs till we should have died. Now you're standing here telling me you're saved. He said, I don't get it. I said, it's above my pay grade. Amen. I said, I can't explain it. All I know is I'm not the same. I said, I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. See, we walk a different path. And brother, I've been walking it ever since then. Amen. And I found out it's uphill sometimes. Sometimes it's not the easy way. But listen to what it says. Enter ye in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate. Broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Many there be which go in thereat. What folks have failed to understand is this is a straight way. It's a narrow way. See, the new modern religion is trying to make it the wide way. let's make it the wide way where we can fit more. That's not what the scripture says. This is a straight way, a narrow way, and few be there that find it. I'm convinced, men, you can go to church and never have a relationship with God Almighty. I know men that's went to church their whole life and don't even know, have a clue what it feels like to be touched by the hand of God. Go through the motions, sing the song, say amen. Amen, but never know the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I'm talking about true men of God. Amen, that'll bow their head and say, God, touch me. Amen, I need you. You know, you have to swallow pride to do that. It's a straight way. I got about 45 more minutes, but I'll stop in just a minute. God has a path, and it's a good road. As I said, I've traveled both ways. I've lived the life of a sinner, and I lived it good. I was not ashamed of the devil. I wouldn't. I was the one that pulled up at the party. Soon as the car door opened, you knew I was there. Y'all know how? I'd pull up, open the door. Then we come to church and quiet as a church mouse. Wouldn't it be great if they come in, Pastor, and they actually did what the Bible said, enter his gates with thanksgiving and praise. Wouldn't it be great if you men walked in the church doors, amen, you didn't, nobody drag you here, amen, but you walked in, as soon as you walked back through there, woohoo! Let's praise God today, boys. Somebody say, get that joker out of here. But I'm going to just tell you something. This is going to be the quietest place you're ever going to be, man. Amen. I've read it ahead. I've seen it in the book. Amen. When we get to glory, amen, that's what we're going to do. Amen. We're going to praise the King of Kings. Amen. The Bible says with a shout, amen, we will glorify his name. Yeah. Are you a man of God? Then the scripture says, nor does he sit in the seat of the scornful. What does that mean? The seat of the scornful is those that criticize. We got a lot of that going on, don't we? You know, I believe that wouldn't it be great if we had a church like in the book of Acts? You remember how they all gathered together, was in one mind and one accord. They just got together and they just began to worship God and began to lift up his name. Who are you listening to? And where are you walking? How many of you believe the Lord can speak to you? Raise your hand. Thank God. You know, the scripture bears it out because it says, we'll know his voice, and another we will not follow. Ain't it good to recognize the voice of God? I was outside the other day tending to my dog, and a voice came to me just as clear. And this is what the voice said. Watch your step. Now, if you put two and two together, I was outside tending to my dog. And the voice came to me and said, watch your step. Does everybody get what I'm putting down, right? You get what I'm saying. Watch your step. But I'm going to just tell you something, the way the Lord works with me. I stopped when I heard that. And I stood still because I knew that voice. And I knew it meant more than I thought. Because I stopped and I just stood there in my yard. Watch your step. And all of a sudden I felt the Spirit of the Lord come upon me. He said, that's what you need to tell them men. Watch where you're stepping. Amen. You need to look where you're going. Amen. I'm going to tell you, if you ain't got a path in front of you, you're in trouble. Right. You need to watch where you're stepping. You say, was that the Lord? Had to have been. Because Psalm 37 says the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Would you stand with me? And it also says, not only are the steps of a good man ordered by the Lord, he delighteth in his way. Verse 24 says, though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. If you'll stay with me tomorrow night, we're going to talk about what the man of God can do instead of what he can't do. But if you'll stay with me till Sunday morning, I will show you what a true man looks like. Because when I was brought up, I was thought I knew what a man was supposed to be. How many of you believe a man is supposed to be rough, tough, not soft hands? That's an inside joke. Just kidding, brother. That's not what makes a man, but we'll talk about it. I want you to search your hearts tonight, because if you're anywhere where I am, you'll see, first of all, I take too much counsel from the world. Too much time spent in this world. Too much stuff coming in from this world. Number two, where are you walking? Men, where are you walking at? What's your life like? What is your life like tonight, man?
Is it pleasing before a holy and a righteous God? Can you stand there tonight and say, I have a pure and clear heart? I'm 100% sure that God's satisfied with me. Or can you be as I am and say, God, have mercy on me. I'm not the man I should be. And could you say, God, help me to be the man that you want me to be? What this world needs is some good, godly men. I'm going to close with this. He needs you to be a godly man at your house, with your wife, with your children. But he also needs good, godly men in his house to lead people in the ways of righteousness. I've heard it for years, if it wasn't for the women, the church would have died a long time ago. Y'all ever heard a statement like that? You know what the sad part is? It's almost true. The men are supposed to lead their families into the house of God. Brother, will you play softly?